Okay, there she is. Hi, Jann, Arden. How are you?
Hello.
Going okay so far? We've got you here, so that's half the battle.
Yes.
It's wonderful.
The technical part is over now. We're
oh,
good.
Well, you say that, but we're not there yet.
We connected and nothing went wrong, and yeah, we're all right.
Knock on something. That's great. So welcome to everybody. We're up to about 140 people that have joined so far. So that's very exciting. This is actually our 11th social distance book club since we closed our doors on March 17th. We can't believe it's been that long. My name is Lee Puttifat. I'm the manager of public service at Milton Public Library. And it's my absolute honor to welcome you, Jann, to our social distance book club. So welcome.
Nice to meet you.
Thank you for letting me stalk you on Twitter and shamelessly invite you to our our library. So I thought maybe we could start there, talking about public libraries. I know last April, when we had a bit of trouble here in Ontario with our provincial government and some announcements that were made about funding, you were one of our Canadian icon celebrities that stood up for us on social media and in the media proper. And the quote that I pulled, the tweet that you had put up was, "Reading gave me a career and saved me a few times too." So I'm wondering if you could expand on that and maybe give us some insight into your history with reading and public libraries.
Yeah, no, certainly. I mean, obviously my experience with libraries in general started in public school. Mm-hmm. I went to a very, very small country school in Springbank, Alberta. I still live out here. I live just a few miles from where I grew up. But I, you know, was kind of in a tumultuous family. My dad was a big drinker and my mom worked and we kind of had to entertain ourselves. So, I mean, I was constantly taking books out of the library. My parents were also very big readers, but I just would get lost in it. I was fascinated with stories, probably just wanting to escape, you know, real life. I was one of those kids reading books under the blankets at night with a flashlight. I love sitting in the library, looking through books, discovering new authors, finding new series to read. I remember reading everything Enid Blyton ever wrote over and over and over, and going through all the Nancy Drew, going through all the Hardy Boys. You know, I was very young and started to read like the Lord of the Rings trilogies, which was way over my head. I think I gave up and waited till I was 14 or 15 to start to dig into those again. But I love words. I always have. I love storytelling, and I'm still a huge reader now. I probably read a book every week.
That's amazing. And we find, you know, with our physical doors closed, we're pushing as much as we can out through our e-resources and online resources. But we've just opened the doors for curbside delivery today, actually.
Great.
So my first delivery to a car, it was filled with 6 kids, and they were all screaming, "It's the librarian!" And, you know, nothing makes you feel like a superhero than seeing kids happy to read a book.
No, and I think when something is taken out of your day-to-day life, you certainly take it for granted, you know, when you have accessibility constantly. I mean, libraries play such a huge role. And it's not just about taking out a book. Libraries are multimedia. You know, a lot of libraries are the only places that people are able to access a computer or go online or find information or go and read the newspaper or gather to meet just, you know, friends and have a visit. I mean, libraries are not just, you know, nerdy people walking with their card and taking books out on birding. Yeah. It is a resource for mental wellness and a sense of community. They play such an important role, and they have for thousands and thousands of years. The most cherished things on this planet, and you can ask anyone who is involved in anthropology, archaeology, you know, any kind of history, it's books, it's written word, it is people from thousands of years ago scraping something into a rock that basically said, "I am here." So literature, it really is at the forefront of us as a civilization. There, I mean, whenever you hear things about the Dead Sea Scrolls, you know, anything biblical, anything that's found, any little scrap of something that's from Egypt, you know, with a fragment of a worker that's written something on there, I think we realize how important the written word is. And so libraries still play that very important role.
Absolutely. And as we shift and evolve, we actually have 2 positions in our library, where one is a community-led librarian, where she just connects with vulnerable populations and, you know, job seekers, newcomers, all of those people who have nowhere else to go. And we have a, you know, a new and emerging technology librarian that's bringing in the tech that you're talking about that people don't have access to. So it's accessibility. Yeah.
Yeah, no, it's great that they can go in and get on Wi-Fi and I mean, a friend of mine, even her mom went and took a bunch of iPad lessons at her local library. She was there with some other seniors taking, you know, or just, you know, smart tab lessons so that she could learn how to FaceTime and stuff like that. So
So what are you reading right now during this lockdown?
I'm reading a book called Holy Fools. It was written in 2005. I can't think of the author's name right now. It takes place in France in the 16th century.
Cool.
17th century, actually. And it's just very interesting about a woman hiding out with her child at a convent. Good guys and bad guys. But I think I've been stuck in, 14th, 15th, 16th century Europe for about my last 5 novels. I keep getting sucked into that. And I'm just I'll stay there for a while. But I love history stuff. I love fictional history.
Mm-hmm. Oh, that's cool. Well, we've got lots of those at the library too. So yes. I guess that's a good transition into the book that we're here to discuss tonight, which is Feeding My Mother, Comfort and Laughter in the Kitchen as My Mom Lives with Memory Loss. Mm-hmm. So as you know, I've got a bit of a personal connection to this book. I was following you on Twitter and Facebook as my mom went down this nasty road. She was diagnosed about 2014, and she actually died Christmas Eve 2018, 4 days before your mom. So it was your words to me just gave me so much solace so much hope, but you made me laugh. Like, some of this stuff is kind of funny, like the stuff that happens and the things you say. But yeah, I'm wondering, you know, you really helped me. What helped you during this crazy time? I know your book is essentially a journal. Was it journaling?
Yeah, no, definitely laughing for sure.
Yeah.
I think, you know, we've talked a little bit about just a sense of community. When I first started writing about both my parents in 2014, mm-hmm. I remember putting my first little blog out there on Facebook because I didn't really understand what was happening. My mom had been forgetful for quite a few years before this, my mom and dad both. Mm-hmm. So I'd been dealing with it for 3 or 4 years, but I was in denial. So when I threw this blog out there, I was amazed at how many people wrote back. I think there was like 1.2 million people that it reached. There was 7,000 or 8,000 or 9,000 comments. My manager had phoned me the next day and just said, have you seen what's happening with your Facebook page? And so I think I realized very quickly how many people were dealing with memory loss with a loved one, parent, sister, grandmother, mother, father. So I think that helped me a lot right out of the gate, to be honestly. I was just like, oh, I'm not alone.
Mm-hmm. That's huge. Yeah, I found when I was reading the book too, there was a lot of, oh my God, this is me. And I'm going to really try not to like hijack this interview and talk about me the whole time.
No, you do your thing. You know, so I think it's much more about how people react to it. I think the stories are, there's so many common threads, right? You go through the memory police is something that really sticks out to me throughout the book. When I realized that by me trying to correct my mom all the time, I was distancing myself. I was frustrating her. I was frustrating me. And it was probably the last thing that I finally gave into. I don't know why I wanted to be right all the time, but so many thousands of people resonated with that. The memory police, they knew exactly what I meant because they spent so much of their time just saying, no, Mom, it wasn't Uncle Bob. It was Uncle Fred. And we weren't in Airdrie. We were in Red Deer. And I mean, all these banal things you seem to get right. You know, oh, your dad and I went up that mountain in 71. No, we didn't. We were never there. And what? Why? So yeah. I think that was one of the biggest takeaways from feeding my mother and what people talk to me about randomly, coffee shops, stores, malls, after concerts was, thank you for writing that down, because when I stopped correcting my whomever, my life really changed.
Mm-hmm. My dad used to do it with dates. He's like, what day is it, Ann? And she's like, Monday. It's like, it's Wednesday. Say it's Wednesday. And he would make her say it. And it was, and we had the same sort of reaction, like, what the hell are you doing? Like, it doesn't matter. But to him, if she knew what day it was, she was going to be okay. And this was a temporary passage, right?
Yes. You think it's going to get better. Mm-hmm. You think suddenly they're going to wake up and it doesn't. It's just, it's an unwinnable battle.
Yeah.
And I'm a very competitive person. So
same.
I just felt like if I yelled or raised my voice, I spent quite a few years just in that place where I wasn't the daughter anymore. I was some kind of a weird gatekeeper.
Right.
And when I finally gave into that and went where my mother went, instead of trying to drag her where I was, mm-hmm. it really changed everything. But we did laugh a lot. I mean, my God, I laughed a lot. My mom had so many wise things that she bestowed upon me really right up until her death. She was very elegant and graceful, but she said some great things to me that will inform me the rest of my life. It became not sad anymore. It was just, once you accept things. And she wasn't in pain. Mm-hmm. She wasn't begging me to come home. And she was only in a memory, like a nursing home for, I think, 9.5 months. So I kept her at home most of the time.
That's incredible, because it's a lot. Even just things like stairs, right? Or getting out of bed without that lifting equipment and things. I know there was many times we were there doing it.
Big too, with memory loss. Once the hygiene part of a person's... Oh, yeah. It is not something that you can keep doing. And you have to keep in mind, too, I had lots of help. I felt very fortunate that I was in a position to pay a little bit extra to keep mom there. But, you know, we're in a rural setting. My parents' home was 100 yards from my house, and I'm not near a city. You know, we were out of town, mm-hmm. but I really leaned on my friends a lot, too. Mm-hmm. And everyone took shifts. You know, it really does take a village to make this work. But everyone just laughed, and they would tell me stuff that she said, and your mom did this, and she... It's so different for everybody. I dealt with a different version of my parent, and I'm sure you can relate to this. Every couple of weeks, I had a different version of my mom. I'm like, oh, this is new. She was just doing new things. Yeah. I've always done that. I'm like, okay.
Yeah, yeah. I used to walk in, and she'd say, are you Lee number one or Lee number two today? I'm like, I don't know. Like, who do you think I am? It was quite funny, just how her brain worked. But the laughter part really resonated through the book, and obviously your social media posts. But in the book, there's the scene where your dad puts the turkey in the oven with the loaf of bread in the plastic. So it was so weird. Yeah. I was screenshotting it, sending it to my dad and my brother. We all live in the same city. And then I just sent the book directly to their house. My mom, 3 days before Christmas, she was determined, hell-bent she was going to host Christmas dinner. So she called me on the 22nd. She said, I'm stuffing the turkey today. I said, well, it's a little early and we're all going to die of salmonella, but you do what you got to do, mom. So she stuffed the turkey, and I got a call at midnight that night from my dad. And he's like, your mom's lost it. She's unstuffing the turkey. Can you go to the store, buy a new turkey, and come over and help us stuff it? So my husband and I drove to the all night grocery and bought a turkey and bought the stuffing. And we were there till 2-3 in the morning stuffing that bird, and woke up in the morning and she phoned. She goes, we're going to die of salmonella from this turkey. You got to come over and unstuff. We did it 3 times. So we just kept stuffing the bird and buying a new, and it was quite hilarious. And then I just brought a turkey from home. But what is it about Christmas and food? You know, your entire book is about the catharsis of food.
Well, it was an activity that they really looked forward to. You know, food is still very big. With my mom, I mean, Alzheimer's manifests itself in each individual in very different ways, but there are still, mm-hmm. I think, some constants that, but for me, it was like to have mom chop an onion, she would chop it for me, you know, until it was like paste, but I could set it there, you know, with a small knife, nothing giant. I didn't want her to take her arm off, but food was big, and I fed my parents every night. I had them from 4 till 8. And then when my dad passed away, I had my mom. But food was big. You know, my dad would ask, he would show up at my house like at 6 o'clock in the morning and ask me what was for lunch. I fed him many times at my counter. I mean, that's what you get when your parents live across the street from you or across the field. And, but my mom, you know, she really enjoyed food. And I think, you know, when I called the book Feeding My Mother, it was so many conversations at the dinner table. There were so many enlightening moments. There was so many things that I got to ask her about, mm-hmm. you know, certainly earlier on that she did remember. And I just thought, I knew I better ask her this stuff now. Some of it was lost, but a lot of times she was right about things and where they came from and how they ended up in Calgary and when she met my dad. And I mean, I knew a lot of the stories anyway, but I would ask her. And but yeah, food was big. And I enjoyed sitting at the table and having her participate in the meals. And, you know, every time I fed her, I'd say, how is it, mom? Well, it's absolutely delicious. She said the same thing every time.
Awesome.
Do you want pie? Well, what do you think? Right. I said, I think you want pie.
Yeah.
Well, I always made them dessert too. So I just, my road manager, Chris Brunton, who kind of, you know, him and I worked on the idea of what the book could be, was we just thought we should throw the recipes in. I loved things that were interactive. Mm-hmm. And I thought it would give people a more of a tactile experience of, you know, what I was going through. And I know food's big with most people. Mm-hmm. Mealtimes. Mm-hmm. You can sit them down and put a plate in front of them. And especially when they can still feed themselves, it's pretty special.
Yeah. Well, and I loved that about your book as well, that you put in the pictures of your mom before she was sick. So you're showing her as an entire, you know, holistic person. You've got the recipes, you've got the journal, like you really respected her life for people like me who were going through something like that. And all you're seeing is the end. You forget there was, you know, 80 years there or 60 years there.
Yeah, she was 82 when she died. Wow. And she had started with Alzheimer's at 72. So we'd been dealing with it for a decade.
Yeah.
But it is. You do forget the person. I was very bitter about that. And I wrote about that because I remember writing down one day, I'm like, I don't know if I love this person. And I cried and cried about it. And I was very frightened to write the words down because I thought, what kind of a monster do I look like, you know, to say that about my own mom?
Yeah.
I don't know if I love this person because she was so different. And I didn't have my ally anymore. I knew she was there. And sometimes she would rise to the surface for me and say something profound, and then she would dip down beneath the water. I always likened it to her being, you know, Captain Ahab strapped on Moby Dick's back, and they'd come up for a gulp of air, and then that great whale would dive down. And I mean, that's a book that I read over and over as a kid. You know, that's what Alzheimer's seemed like to me. Mm-hmm. But I love the pictures. To me, it really is a love letter to my mom, especially the hardback cover. Of the hardback is included with all those photographs. And my mom was such a beautiful person, and she was so fine featured, and she was very talented and super funny without knowing it. And my mom was so interesting. I remember even growing up, she'd say, I'm your mother, I'm not your friend.
Yeah.
And that really hurt me as a teenager, but it really has still resonates with me. My mother was never my friend. And I know people might think, what? My mom made that very clear to me. I'm not your friend, I'm your mom. And it was more than a friend. She didn't mean to diminish it. Of course she loved me more than anything on the planet. But when I was growing up and she was teaching me how to be a person, and she did right to the very last breath of her life teach me.
Oh.
To the very last second.
Yeah.
And I'm still getting taught. I'm still resurrecting things that was said. I mean, anyone that's lost a parent, you keep sifting through what's left behind. Mm-hmm. And then you go, oh, right. Yes. Mm-hmm. But I mean, she just was a really excellent person. Oh, and the reason that I was able to even go into music was because of my mom. My dad too, but my dad and I had a very contentious relationship the whole time I was growing up. I got to know him, you know, near the end, and I wrote about him a little bit in the book, but my next book actually that's out in October is much more about my dad, which is interesting.
Ooh, that was one of our questions. What's your next book? So
it's out in October. It's called If I Knew Then. And it's just about becoming a certain age. I talk a lot about, you know, entering into your 50s and finally feeling like you're a person that the person for certainly for me that I want to be, the person that I always aspired to be, and that you kind of take no hostages. You just have a real sense of what you want to do. So, but I ended up writing quite a bit about my father. And it's quite a funny book as well. I finished it last August, but it'll be out in I think the 12th of October or something like that. So
that's great. Yeah, it's funny because this book, I mean, you do talk a lot about the themes of denial and guilt and anger, like you're saying, mixed in with the laughter. How are you processing that now? And is writing about your dad helping as well? Because it's so hard when you're in that moment and you write about not crying. And I remember looking at my husband one night going, why have I not cried once about this? It's like, I'm so frustrated, but it's not coming out. And I think it's a pretty natural reaction. But over the past 2 years, I've been able to process all of those emotions because I'm not dealing with it.
Oh, yeah. Distance is great. I mean, I cried a lot with my mom all throughout, but I really still haven't cried much about my dad.
Hmm.
And I loved him, but I didn't like him very much.
Right.
And I do love him now. He's been gone. He's been gone. It'll be 5 years this August. God, it seems like yesterday. But he died on my mother's birthday, which always makes me laugh because, you know, and mom was well into Alzheimer's and she said, well, he just wanted to put a damper on my birthday. He didn't want us to forget him, she said to me. And then she accused me of killing him. Well, I saw you give him that needle.
Yeah.
And I saw you putting that glass on his face, and I think it was the mask. I think it was the oxygen mask that she, but yeah, she told, I heard her on the phone telling neighbors and people that were phoning to console her that I had had him put to sleep.
Right.
Which is funny in hindsight. Yeah. I'm like, yeah. Mom, it's against the law. I'd be in jail. Well, I know what I saw, she said.
Yeah. Yeah. My mom used to tell her nursing staff that I would feed her food with, or soup with fingers in it. I was like, what? Because one time I said, if it feels too hot, put your finger in it. She's like, oh, it's not okay to eat people, right? It was, but she would go and tell people I was feeding for this. You have to watch yourself.
No, and then they get, I always called it getting hooked on something.
Yes.
Get stuck on something and it just goes around and around and around.
In a feedback loop, yeah. So, you know, we're looking at the statistics. We do a lot of work with the Alzheimer's Society at the library as well. And I know there's roughly, I think, 600,000 people in Canada right now currently living with Alzheimer's, supposed to get up to about 1 million in 10 to 15 years, I believe, and 65% are women. So what's really been interesting since we've posted to our community that we were going to talk to you about this book tonight was how many people are afraid to read your book because they're terrified of the emotions it'll release and what it'll bring out. They don't see the catharsis yet. So I'm wondering, you know, if, to kind of help alleviate their fears. And our community right now, we're up to about 210 people. If you have any questions, please put them in and I can read them along the bottom. But what advice do you have for them about what that shared experience and the community of people can help to get through these experiences?
Well, I think contrary to what people think, that it would be something sort of negative and to kind of break apart that facade. If you have someone with memory loss and Alzheimer's and dementia, it's not going to get any better.
Yeah.
And but it can get easier. So the disease in and of itself is going to do what it does, but there's so much joy to be had. And there's a lot of reconciliation that can be done between a child and a parent. Mm-hmm. When the caregiving roles are changed, and a lot of people do have tumultuous relationships with their parents their entire lives. They have fights, they have arguments, they have a mother that's domineering or a father that was this or that. And through Alzheimer's, there's so many things that can shift. Mm-hmm. And so many wonderful things that can happen. A lot of forgiveness, a lot of letting go of ideas. You know, when you care for somebody that you particularly don't think cared for you even growing up, there's something, that filial piety that is so lacking in North American culture, where, you know, other cultures, the parents and the grandparents are always absorbed into the family. Many, several multi-families live in one home in many, many parts of the world. But here we don't do it that way. We separate out, children move away thousands of miles away. Parents end up in nursing homes or retirement villages, and there's a real separation as people get older. But I will never regret looking after my parents, and I had a lot of laughs. I think especially with my dad, you know, a guy that I just didn't like very much, that I never understood. I learned a lot about, he was just a person. Mm-hmm. He was a person with an addiction. He was struggling with issues of his own, and I never saw him as another fellow human being. I saw him as my dad.
Right.
So much more good will come out of it than bad. And I think you will glean helpful hints. I always call Feeding My Mother my book of mistakes.
Right.
Because I made so many mistakes. And then when I finally found my rhythm, it was a real lifesaver for me. So I always tell people, just read it, because you'll avoid so many of the things that I did. Like, I stopped feeling guilty. I knew I was doing the best I could. I knew I was making the best decisions that I could.
Yeah.
And, you know, you learn to lean on your friends and to ask for help. I'm terrible at asking for help. Terrible.
Right.
I'm very private. I don't like to know. I don't want people to know there's anything wrong. I don't like showing weakness. And all those things disappeared. Mm-hmm. I just thought, I'm not doing good. And I need help.
Yeah.
So, you know, it made me a much better version of myself. There's nothing to be afraid of reading the book. It's funny. It's not science-y. It's not filled with statistics that you don't need to know. It's a very human experience that's really funny. So they don't need to worry about that. And there's some good recipes in there.
That's right, there is. It's also really well written, and from a bunch of English literature nerds. I mean, we all loved your similes and the funny way that you compared things. So it was really well, it was an easy read, and it was an enjoyable read. So.
Oh, thank you. I appreciate that.
Well, we've kept you for half an hour. We totally appreciate that you've given us this and shared your experience with us. There is one question that I have to ask for one of the staff at Milton Public Library.
Yes.
She's incredibly stressed out about the cliffhanger at the end of season one. And she wants to know if you'll tell us anything about what's going to happen in season two.
Season two of Jann has been finished since December. So people are like, oh my gosh, did you have to stop filming? We were done filming in November. It's all edited, ready to go. Because of COVID, it's been pushed a bit. So they're rerunning season one right now, Mondays at 9 o'clock on CTV. So they've just done the first episode. Season two kind of picks up, you know, my sister Max is pregnant. Obviously, okay. She has to have that baby come out of her body. So you can imagine sort of what that looks like as they add another child to their family.
Right.
I'm still on the road to kind of wreck and ruin lots of ridiculous situations. I really have no sense of what goes on around. My character has no sense. I'm so grateful that this is fictitious. People always say, is that your house? Is that your... Right. Obviously, it is fiction, and that's not my house. My mother is no longer with us, but in the show, she's still alive, and I don't have a sister.
Right.
So, I think people will absolutely love the second season. It picks up all those little pieces that we left dangling. Nothing gets left unresolved. I'm still terrible with personal relationships. It's just that all the characters are back, and it's bigger and better than ever. I mean, we're plowing ahead with season three now, but you know, we'll come out of this. Good things do come out of bad things. And hopefully we won't go back to normal. Hopefully we'll go back to better than normal. Yeah. The whole world, you know, what a time to be alive this is.
Yeah.
I'm glad you guys are able to start slowly getting books out there to people, and I just want people to be of good cheer. You know, I think the sunshine of going into the summer and being able to be outside a little bit for young people and old people, all of us, is going to make a big difference. But we'll get there. We're getting there. There are things improving. So everyone stay positive, stay optimistic. Time is wise. And people have been through much worse things than what we're doing now. We're all doing this together, right? So it's pretty amazing.
That's right. And if we all look out for one another, we'll get through this quicker, which would be great. So it's wonderful.
We're getting there. And I think, too, we can't be so hard on people. Everyone's so different. I mean, fear makes us do lots of things and people get frustrated. And these are really hard times. So we have to take a breath, be more understanding. Yeah, sometimes young people, they make mistakes and they want to. I think if I was 20, I'd be one of those people out there sitting in a park and having a cold drink and visiting with my friends and, you know, regretting it afterwards. But it's so hard when you have something so invisible like a virus, because everything looks so normal. And, you know, we're getting there. We're slowly getting there.
Absolutely.
Well, we just have to be easy on each other. It's so easy to get mad. And boy, are we ever learning that lesson through everything that's happening right now is we have to be kinder to each other and more tolerant. And I'm learning all the time. I'm learning to shut up and listen.
Well, keep talking too, because we're loving everything you're putting on social media. This has been one of the highlights of my career so far. So thank you so much for joining us.
Are you lead number one or lead number two?
I'm lead number one tonight.
Okay,
I'm winning. So thank you, Jann, so much. And thank you everyone for joining us. We'll be back next week with local Miltonian Tara Ross. The week after, we've got Clara Hughes to discuss Open Mind, Open Heart.
And
we've got Robin Doolittle coming to talk about how to come.
Great. Funny human being.
She's so cool. I saw her at a conference.
Clara's so lovely. This is so great you're doing this, Lee. When next time I'm in Milton, I'll come in personally.
Please do.
Yeah, we'll
come in. There's a local pub. Hopefully it's open by then. And we'll go. We'll have a drink. We'll enjoy
it.
Fabulous, Jann. Thank you so much. And take care, everyone. We'll
see you
next week.
Thank you.
Thanks, Jann. Bye.